So let's begin. My dear brothers and sisters, on this most sacred night in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life, the Church calls upon her sons and daughters scattered throughout the world to come together to watch and pray. If we keep the memorial of the Lord's Paschal solemnly in this way, listening to his word and celebrating his mysteries, then we shall have the sure hope of sharing his triumph over death. So let us pray. O God, who through your Son bestowed upon the faithful the fire of your glory, sanctify this new fire, we pray, and grant that by the Paschal celebration may we be so inflamed with heavenly desire that with minds made pure we may attain festivities of unending splendor through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, and the Omega, the Alpha and Omega, all times belong to him, in all ages, to him be glory and power, through every age and forever and ever. Amen. By his holy and glorious wounds, may Christ the Lord guard us and protect us. Amen. May the light of Christ rising in glory dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds.
This is the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
This is the light of Christ. Thank you. This is the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Life from her eternal key.
Dear brothers and sisters, now that we've begun our solemn vigil, let's listen with quiet hearts to the word of God. Let us meditate on how God, in times past, saved his people. And in these last days, has sent us his Son as our Redeemer. Let us pray that our God may complete this paschal work of salvation by the fullness of redemption. I ask you now to please be seated for the first reading. You can extinguish your candles.
A reading from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heaven and the earth was a formless wasteland, and darkness covered the abyss, while a mighty wind swept over the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw how good the light was. God then separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. Thus, evening came and morning followed, the first day.
Then God said, "Let there be a dome in the middle of the waters to separate one body of water from the other." And so it happened. God made the dome, and it separated the water above the dome from the water below it. God called the dome the sky. Evening came and morning followed, the second day.
Then God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered into a single basin so that the dry land may appear." And so it happened. The water under the sky was gathered into its basin and the dry land appeared. God called the dry land the earth. And the basin of water he called the sea. God saw how good it was. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth vegetation, every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it." And so it happened. The earth brought forth every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it. God saw how good it was. Evening came, and morning followed, the third day.
Then God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate day from night. Let them mark the fixed times, the days and the years, and serve as luminaries in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth." And so it happened. God made the two great lights, the greater one to govern the day, and the lesser one to govern the night. And he made the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. God saw how good it was. Evening came and morning followed, the fourth day.
Then God said, Let the water teem with an abundance of living creatures. And on the earth, let birds fly beneath the dome of the sky. And so it happened. God created the great sea monsters and all kinds of swimming creatures with which the sea teems, and all kinds of winged birds. God saw how good it was, and God blessed them, saying, "Be fertile, multiply, fill the waters of the sea, and let the birds multiply on the earth." Evening came, and morning followed, the fifth day.
Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth all kinds of living creatures, cattle, creeping things, and wild animals of all kinds." And so it happened. God made all kinds of wild animals, all kinds of cattle, and all kinds of creeping things of the earth. God saw how good it was. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and the cattle, and over all the wild animals, and all the creatures that crawl on the ground." God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, saying, "Be fertile and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and all the living things that move on earth." God also said, "See, I give you every seed-bearing plant all over the earth, and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit on it to be your food, and to all the animals of the land, all the birds of the air, and all the living creatures that crawl on the ground. I give all the green plants for food." And so it happened. God looked at everything he had made, and he found it very good. Evening came, and morning followed, the sixth day.
Since on the seventh day God was finished with the work he had been doing, he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had undertaken. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Pray. Remain seated.
O God, who wonderfully created human nature and still more wonderfully redeemed it, grant us, we pray, to set our minds against the enticements of sin, that we may merit to attain eternal joys through Christ our Lord.
Amen. A reading from the book of Genesis. God put Abraham to the test. He called to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son Isaac, your only one whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah. There you shall offer him up as a holocaust on a height that I will point out to you." Early the next morning, Abraham saddled his donkey, took with him his son Isaac and two of his servants as well, and with the wood that he had cut for the holocaust, set out for the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham got sight of the place from afar. Then he said to his servants, "Both of you stay here with the donkey, while the boy and I go on over yonder. We will worship and then come back to you." Thereupon Abraham took the wood for the holocaust and laid it on his son Isaac's shoulders, while he carried the fire and the knife. As the two walked on together, Isaac spoke to his father Abraham. "Father," Isaac said. "Yes, son," he replied. Isaac continued, "Here are the fire and the wood, but where is the sheep for the holocaust?" "Son," Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the sheep for the holocaust." Then the two continued going forward. When they came to the place of which God had told them, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. Next, he tied up his son Isaac and put him on top of the wood on the altar. Then he reached out and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the Lord's messenger called to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he answered. "Do not lay your hand on the boy," said the messenger. "Do not do the least thing to him. I know now how devoted you are to your son and to God, since you did not withhold from me your own beloved son." As Abraham looked about, he spied a ram caught up by its horns in the thicket. So he went and took the ram and offered it up as a holocaust in place of his son. Abraham named the site Yahweh Yireh. Hence people now say, "On the mountain the Lord will see." Again, the Lord's messenger called to Abraham from heaven and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you acted as you did, in not withholding from me your beloved son, I will bless you abundantly and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants, all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. All this because you obeyed my command." The word of the Lord.
You are my inheritance, O Lord. nor will you suffer your faithful one to undergo corruption. You are my inheritance, O Lord.
Let us pray.
O God, Supreme Father of the faithful, who increased the children of your promise by pouring out the grace of adoption throughout the whole world, and through the Paschal mystery, make your servant Abraham father of all nations. As you once you swore, grant we pray that your peoples may enter worthily into the grace to which you call them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward. And you, lift up your staff, and with hand outstretched over the sea, split the sea in two, that the Israelites may pass through it on dry land. But I will make the Egyptians so obstinate that they will go in after them. Then I will receive glory through Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and charioteers. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. When I receive glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and charioteers." The angel of God, who had been leading Israel's camp, now moved and went around behind them. The column of cloud also, leaving the front, took up its place behind them, so that it came between the camp of the Egyptians and that of Israel. But the cloud now became dark, and thus the night passed without the rival camps coming any closer together all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea with a strong east wind throughout the night, and so turned it into dry land. When the water was thus divided, the Israelites marched into the midst of the sea on dry land, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. The Egyptians followed in pursuit. All Pharaoh's horses and charioteers went after them, right into the midst of the sea, in the night watch just before dawn. The Lord cast through the column of the fiery cloud upon the Egyptian force a glance that threw it into a panic, and so clogged their chariot wheels. So clogged their chariot wheels that they could hardly drive. With that, the Egyptians sounded the retreat before Israel, because the Lord was fighting for them against the Egyptians. Then the Lord told Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may flow back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and their charioteers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea flowed back to its normal depth. The Egyptians were fleeing head on toward the sea when the Lord hurled them into its midst. As the water flowed back, it covered the chariots and the charioteers of Pharaoh's whole army, which had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not a single one of them escaped. But the Israelites had marched on dry land through the midst of the sea, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel on that day from the power of the Egyptians. When Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the seashore and beheld the great power that the Lord had shown against the Egyptians, they feared the Lord and believed in him and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord: "I will sing to the Lord, for he is gloriously triumphant. Horse and chariot he has cast into the sea." The word of the Lord.
By the light of the New Testament, have unlocked the meaning of wonders worked in former times, so that the Red Sea prefigures the sacred font the nation delivered from slavery, foreshadows the Christian people. Grant, we pray, that all nations, obtaining the privilege of Israel by merit of faith, may be reborn by partaking of your Spirit, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come, without pain and without cost. Drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me, and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully. Listen, that you may have life. I will renew with you the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David. As I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander of nations, so shall you summon a nation you knew not, and nations that knew you not shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, who has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way, and the wicked man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God, who is generous in forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above yours, and my thoughts above your thoughts. For just as from the heavens the rain and snow come down, and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Almighty ever-living God, sole hope of the world, who by the preaching of your prophets unveiled the mysteries of this present age, graciously increase the longing of your people, for only at the prompting of your grace do the faithful progress in any kind of virtue, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Prophet Ezekiel. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, when the house of Israel lived in their land, they defiled it by their conduct and deeds. Therefore, I poured out my fury upon them because of the blood that they poured out on the ground and because they defiled it with idols. I scattered them among the nations, dispersing them over foreign lands, according to their conduct and deeds. I judged them. But when they came among the nations, wherever they came, they served to profane my holy name, because it was said of them, These are the people of the Lord, yet they had to leave their land. So I have relented because of my holy name, which the house of Israel profaned among the nations where they came. Therefore, say to the house of Israel, Thus says the Lord God, Not for your sakes do I act, house of Israel, but for the sake of my holy name, which you profaned among the nations to which you came. I will prove the holiness of my great name, profaned among the nations, in the midst you have profaned it. Thus the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when in their sight I prove my holiness through you. For I will take you away from among the nations, gather you from all the foreign lands, and bring you back to your own land. I will sprinkle clean water upon you to cleanse you from all your impurities, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. I will give you a new heart and place a new spirit within you, taking from your bodies your stony hearts and giving you natural hearts. I will put my spirit within you and make you live by my statutes, careful to observe my decrees. You shall live in the land I gave your fathers. You shall be my people, and I will be your God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
By the pages of both testaments, instruct and prepare us to celebrate the Paschal mystery. Grant that we may comprehend your mercy so that the gifts we receive from you this night may confirm our hope of the gifts to come through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And let us pray. O God, who make this most sacred night radiant with the glory of the Lord's resurrection, stir up in your church a spirit of adoption, so that renewed in body and mind, we may render you undivided service through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the death by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. For if we have grown into union with him through a death like this, we shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that our sinful body might be done away with, that we might no longer be in slavery to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once and for all. As to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourselves as being dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
With you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary and the mother of James and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. Very early, when the sun had risen on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb. They were saying to one another, "Who will roll back the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And when they looked, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. On entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a white robe. and they were utterly amazed. He said to them, "Do not be amazed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, the crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. But go and tell his disciples and Peter, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him as he told you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good evening. As we celebrate tonight, it would be difficult to imagine a feast day in our liturgical calendar with greater significance than Easter. First of all, the resurrection of Christ is the basis of our Christian faith. It is the greatest of the miracles that proves that Jesus is God. That is why St. Paul in 1 Corinthians writes, "If Christ had not been raised from the dead, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain." Paul also states in Romans, "Jesus is Lord. He is risen." That was the central theme of the preaching of the apostles, because Jesus prophesied it as a sign of his divinity. "Tear down this temple, and in 3 days I will build it again." Easter is a guarantee of our own resurrection. Jesus assured Martha at the tomb of Lazarus, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live, even though he dies." It is very appropriate that at the Easter Vigil, we celebrate the welcoming with great joy and thanksgiving of our catechumens and candidates into full communion in our church, and also that we might administer to the sacrament of confirmation, sealing our members of our faith community with the gift of the Holy Spirit. And our first communicants with the gift of the body and blood of the resurrected Christ. Easter is the appropriate feast because it is a feast that dispels the darkness and illuminates our world. It is a feast that transforms our despair into hope, our fear into trust, in a world that, at times, is very painful, and at times have more than its share of tears and sorrow. It reminds us that life is worth living. The strength to cope with suffering, the ability and the patience to cope with our own relationships is rooted in the promise of new life and of freedom. For this to become a reality, we have to step out of the tombs that we create in our own lives, to bury the things we do not wish to deal with. We dig out tombs where we hide our feelings of inadequacy, our fear of failure, our fear of rejection. We have tombs where we store our broken relationships, our selfishness, our emphasis on all that is material. We have tombs filled with despair and depression. All these tombs bind us and imprison us taking away our freedom and making us the person we really do not want to become. Even though we know that the stones of these tombs have to be rolled back, we fear doing so. Why? Perhaps we become comfortable in our own prison cells. But when we refuse to roll back these stones, when we will not shed those things that rob us of the possibility of experiencing the true freedom of the resurrection, Jesus weeps. He weeps because he cares, just as he wept at the tomb of his good friend Lazarus. Yes, when we lose hope, when we lose faith and trust, Jesus does weep, but he never stops inviting us to roll back those stones and to step out to experience new life and freedom. The cloth that bound the hands and feet of Jesus were on the floor of the tomb. So my question for us this evening, what does it take for us to undo our own bindings and discard them? Yes, it is frightening. It becomes part of our comfort zone, and it's a step into the unknown. Today, let us pray for the grace and the courage to roll back those stones and become people and who are able to shout loud and clear, free at last, thank God, Almighty God, we're free at last.
Please come forward to the front steps and face the congregation.
My dear friends, with one heart and one soul, let us by our prayers come to the aid of these our brothers and sisters in their blessed hope, so that as they approach the fount of rebirth, the Almighty God may bestow on them all his merciful help. Would the catechumens please kneel now facing the altar, and the rest of the congregation either be seated or to kneel.
Isaac, Sarah, Abraham.
And I'll invite the catechumens to come over to the baptismal font. Almighty ever-living God, be present by the mysteries of your great love and send forth the spirit of adoption to create new peoples brought to birth for you in the fount of baptism, so that what is to be carried out by our humble service may be brought to fulfillment by your mighty power. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
O God, who by invisible power accomplish a wondrous effect through sacramental signs, and who in many ways have prepared water, your creation, to show forth the grace of baptism. O God, whose spirit in the first moments of the world's creation hovered over the waters, so that the very substance of water would even then take to itself the power to sanctify. O God, with the outpouring of the flood, overshadow regeneration, so that from the mystery of one and the same element of water would come an end to vice and a beginning of virtue. O God, who caused the children of Abraham to pass dry shod through the Red Sea, so that the chosen people, set free from slavery to Pharaoh, would prefigure the people of the baptized. O God, whose Son, baptized by John in the waters of the Jordan, was anointed with the Holy Spirit, and as he hung upon the cross, gave forth water from his side along with blood, and after his resurrection, commanded his disciples, "Go forth, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." Look now, we pray, upon the face of your church, and graciously unseal for her the fountain of baptism. May this water receive the Holy Spirit, the grace of your only begotten Son, so that human nature, created in your image and washed clean through the sacrament of baptism from all the squalor of the life of old, may be found worthy to rise to the life of newborn children through water and Holy Spirit. May the power of the Holy Spirit, O Lord, we pray, come down through your Son into the fullness of this font, so that all who have been buried with Christ by baptism into death may rise again to life with him who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Springs of water bless the Lord, praise and exalt him above all forever. Springs of water bless the Lord, praise and exalt him above all forever.
At this time I like to, for the first time, recite the baptismal promises for those who have never done so before. Later on in the ceremony, we'll all who have already done it for the first time renew our baptismal vows. So it's just those who are being baptized today. For those making these baptismal promises for the first time, I pray. Dear brothers and sisters, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in the newness of life. And so now that our Lenten observance is concluded, let us recite the promises of holy baptism by renouncing Satan and his works and promise to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask you, do you renounce sin so as to live in the freedom of God's children? Do you renounce the lure of evil so that sin may have no mastery over you? I do. Do you renounce Satan, the author and prince of sin? I do. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death, and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? And may Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed on us forgiveness of our sins, keep us by his grace in Christ Jesus our Lord for eternal life for all. Amen. Now, the parents, if you're all here, if not, please come forward. And please stand in front of the altar.
Father Tom, we are blessed to have three families joining us tonight, so we'll call the families together. Alexander and Tatiana.
Alexander, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Tatiana, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Sarah, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Matthew, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you. Charles, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Casey, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
And Ryan.
Ryan, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
We have just heard our newly baptized proclaim their baptismal promises as we or our godparent did at our baptism. We now invite everyone to stand to renew those promises once again. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body and life everlasting?
Water is alive.
said, baptized you are born, clothed in Christ, anointed priest and holy king. Welcome, love.
You have become a new creation and clothed yourself in Christ. Receive this baptismal garment. Do you now ask the godparent to put over you? And bring this white garment unstained to the judgment seat of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that you may have everlasting life. Amen. Godparents, I ask you now to please come forward to give the newly baptized the light of Christ.
Thank you.
you have been enlightened by Christ. Walk always as people of the light, and keep the flame of faith alive in your hearts. And when the Lord comes, may you go out to meet him with all the saints in the heavenly kingdom. Let us all give the newly baptized a round of our applause. Seats.
You may extinguish your candles.
Now the candidates, please come forward with your sponsors for the rite of reception. Of your own free will, you have asked to be received into the full communion of the Catholic Church. You have made your decision after careful thought under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. I now invite you to come forward as you have with your sponsor and in the presence of this community to profess the faith of the Catholic Church. In this faith, you will be one with us for the first time the Eucharistic table of the Lord, the sign of the Church's unity. So I ask you to repeat after me. I believe and profess all that the Holy Catholic Church believes, teaches, and proclaims to be revealed by God. The Lord receives you into the Catholic Church. His loving kindness has led you here, so that in the unity of the Holy Spirit, you may have full communion with us in the faith that you have professed in the presence of his family. You must please return to your seats. And I invite the other priests to please join me here at the altar. My dear candidates for confirmation, by your baptism you have been born again in Christ and become members of Christ and his priestly people. Now you are to share in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit sent by the Lord upon his apostles at Pentecost and given them and their successors in baptism. I ask you to be confirmed to please stand. The promised strength of the Holy Spirit that you are to receive will make you more like Christ and help you to be witnesses to his suffering, death, and resurrection. It will strengthen you to be active members of the Church and to build up the body of Christ in faith and love. My dear friends, let us pray to God, our Father, that he will pour out the Holy Spirit on these candidates for confirmation, to strengthen them with his gifts and anoint them to be more like Christ, the Son of God. Our powerful God, Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, by water and the Holy Spirit, you freed your sons and daughters from sin and gave them new life. Send your Holy Spirit upon them to be their helper and guide. Give them the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of right judgment and courage, the spirit of knowledge and reverence. Fill them with the spirit of wonder and awe in your presence. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Joseph, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
And be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
Amen. Joseph, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
May the Lord guide you and, fill you with the Spirit. Your spiritual journey, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
Benazir, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
Mary. Mary, be sealed with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Lucy, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
May the Lord march with you. May the Spirit guide you as you continue your spiritual journey. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
Virgil, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
Martha, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Emily, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
Teresa, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Gregory, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Joan of Arc, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Lily? Louis? Louise, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
Thank you.
Steve. Francis of Assisi, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Gabriel, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Francis, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you. Confirmed, please stand. And let us give him a warm welcome. Brought their fan club. I invite everybody to please stand. My friends, at this feast of feasts, we pray to have all the excitement of our ancestors in faith, and we remember all those whose lives can be immeasurably better because Jesus is risen. Our response is, risen Christ, hear our prayers.
For renewed faith in the resurrection and in life, we pray.
Risen Christ, hear our prayers.
For all Christians whose mission is to bear witness to the risen Christ, we pray.
Risen Christ, hear our prayers.
For openness to what God has yet to show us, we pray. For those who live in circumstances that deny life, those deep in violence, poverty, and any kind of inhumanity, we pray. For the grace to trust others as reliable witnesses, especially those who do not look or sound like us, we pray. For the newly baptized and those newly received into the church, we pray. For those who are sick or in need of any kind, we pray especially for Elizabeth Barona, Father John Sullivan, we pray. For those who have died, and for all who need the good news of the resurrection, especially William Burke, father of Carl Boulain, Anne Inzono Borgia, mother of Philip Borgia, Domenica Inzano Gallipo, aunt of Philip Borgia, Thomas Murphy, brother-in-law of Monica Gomez, Father John P. Skye, uncle of Barbara Todaro, Ann Ian, mother of John Tapley, Kyle Whitehead, son of Jane and Charlie Whitehead, we pray. And for the parishioners of St. Anne's, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray.
Triumphant God, who brings victory over death, we come to you with our needs, confident of your care for us. Help us to live as the earliest witnesses to the resurrection, proclaiming life in all that we say and do. And we ask this in the name of Jesus, the risen Christ. Amen. Please be seated. There is a second collection for the Archdiocesan Seminarians. My sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, we ask, O Lord, the prayers of your people, the sacrificial offerings, that what has begun in the Paschal Mysteries may, by working of your power, bring us to the healing of eternity. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your
lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim, O Lord, on this night of your resurrection, above all to lodge you more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory. Fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, Wilton Daniel, our Archbishop, Luis and David, our auxiliary bishops, all the clergy, and all those who serve your church. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. And mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, Saint Anne, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
And deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who says to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. And let us share with one another a sign of peace.
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy. In the body and blood of Christ, keep us safe for everlasting life.
Thank you.
before we go on anymore, I just want to acknowledge all those who just made their first communions, especially some of the young kids in our parish that are receiving the Eucharist for the first time, as well as some of the adults. I thought they all looked sharp tonight, their fancy dresses. May the Lord journey with you this very sacred night. You bring the gift of His Eucharist to those who cannot be here with us today. Bring with them our care and concern for them. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Thanks. And also, before I say the concluding prayer, I'd like just to thank all those. I'm not going to start by name, because I'd have to mention my name too many times. Who made this ceremony tonight, this liturgy, so beautiful. And like I said, I'm just going to thank Anne-Marie Martin. There she is. Stand up, Anne-Marie. This was her first time as Director of Adult Formation, to put this all together, and she did a wonderful job, and with her staff and, you know, the RCA team and all those who taught the music and lectors and altar servers. And but most of all, for you, those who have been received into the church tonight have received some sacrament. You know, it's a proud night for the pastor of any parish to have experienced what we experienced tonight. So it's a proud evening for me, and I'm very proud of each and every one of you. It was a great bunch of people, and I'm sure we're going to be seeing them. We better be seeing them around. Well, I'll have to go looking for them. All right. Please stand and let us pray. There is a reception after. In Nolan Hall. Pour out on us, O Lord, the spirit of your love, and in your kindness make those who you have nourished by this Paschal sacrament, become one in mind and heart with you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing.
May the good Lord be with you during the sacred season. May the gift of his spirit and the joy of his resurrection be a source of freedom for each and every one of us. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
The Mass is ended, go in peace. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
I'd like just to make one more remark. I think it was my holy aura that stopped none of the kids crying tonight. Amazing.